As we get into Ecclesiastes chapter 5, before we get there, I want to tell a story that will illustrate what the first part of this chapter is about. We're going to be talking about keeping our promises. Now, if someone says, I promise I will do something, we expect them to do it. In fact, our Lord said, all you have to say is yea and nay. And that is binding. We're to be people of our word. But some promises, though we're to keep them all, some of them are really more critical than others, aren't they? I'll tell you what, when you get married, you know what you do? You promise. Before God, before your family, and to the person you are marrying, you make wedding vows and you promise. And you don't take those vows lightly. I consider the promise that I made to Lori the second most important promise I've ever made in my life. Now, the most important promise is the promise you make to God. You know, when you're baptized for the remission of sins, in a way, what you're doing here, you're promising God that you're going to be faithful to Him. And when you're not, you're breaking a promise. And you don't want to break promises to God. Now, we got to be careful about what we promise, don't we? Since we're bound by our word, then we need to be careful what we promise and what we vow. In the Old Testament, what you would do, you'd plead to God. You'd say, I'm going to make a vow. And either you're asking for help, or maybe because some good fortune came, you vow that you're going to that you're going to thank God for this. You take Jacob. You remember Jacob? When God promised Jacob that he'd be with him, Jacob says, I'll give you a tenth of all I have because you're going to do this. I'm going to give you a tenth of all that I prosper. And he kept that promise. Years later, he came back to the land of Canaan, and he went and he kept that promise and offered to God a tenth of all that he had. And so when we make a promise to God, now that's an important promise. And this chapter starts off telling us, now you be careful what you promise. Let me tell you about Jephthah. We read his story way back in the book of Judges. This is before there were kings in Israel. And this happened in a locality of Gilead. Everything that happened in the Judges didn't happen throughout the whole land. Sometimes it happened in specific places. And here we are in Gilead. And it starts off in Judges chapter 11 telling us, now Jephthah the Gileadite was a mighty man of valor. Let me tell you about him. It wasn't Jephthah's fault. It was his father's fault. Jephthah wasn't born to his father's wife. All his brothers were legitimate sons, but not Jephthah. He was a half-brother, and he was an illegitimate child. And those brothers came to Jephthah and said, Jephthah, we don't want you around here. Not any fault to Jephthah now. They told Jephthah he had to leave Gilead, and he did. But what those brothers didn't realize that they were going to face a challenge. The Ammonites decided they wanted to live in Gilead. And they told the Gileadites they was going to have to leave, or they would drive them out of the land. And you know what they did? They sent for Jephthah. They said, Jephthah, you've got to come help us. See, he's a mighty man of valor. They knew they could count on him. And Jephthah said, well, why should I come help you? You kicked me out. You made me leave. They promised Jephthah that if he would come help them, he could be the ruler of that land and the chief and those in Gilead. Jephthah came back to help his hometown folks. And he came back and he faced off against those Ammonites, and they decided they had some parley here on trying to work this out. They couldn't work it out. And so they knew they're going to have to go into battle one against the other. And here's what Jephthah did. Before he went into the battle in Judges chapter 11, verses 30 and 31, Jephthah vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, If thou shalt without fail deliver the children of Ammon into mine hands, then it shall be that whatsoever cometh forth of the doors of my house to meet me when I return in peace from the children of Ammon shall surely be the Lord's, and I'll offer it up for a burnt offering. Well, Jephthah went out and fought those Ammonites, and he won a great victory. And so with great jubilation, he is returning to his house. And here's what happened. Judges 11, 34 through 35. And Jephthah came to Mizpah and to his house, and behold, his daughter came out to meet him with timbrels and with dances, and she was his only child. Beside her, he had neither son nor daughter. And it came to pass when he saw her that he rent his clothes and said, "Alas, my daughter, thou hast brought me very low. And thou art one of them that trouble me, for I've opened my mouth unto the Lord, and I cannot go back." I tell you, one thing you can admire Jephthah for, he knew what a promise meant. And he was going to keep that promise. But here, his only daughter that came out rejoicing to meet him, he is heartbroken over this. Well, let me tell you how the story comes out. And to tell you the truth, we're not exactly sure how all this came out. He kept his promise, but how he kept it is a little bit ambiguous. Look how this reads. She said unto him, "My father, if thou hast opened thy mouth unto the Lord to do to me according to which thou hast proceeded out of thy mouth, for as much as the Lord hath taken vengeance for thee of thine enemies, even of the children of Ammon." And she said unto her father, "Let this thing be done for me. Let me alone 2 months, that I may go up and down upon the mountains and bewail my virginity, I and my fellows." So it says, he said, "Go." And he sent her away for 2 months. And she went with her companions and bewailed her virginity upon the mountains. And it came to pass at the end of 2 months that she returned to her father, who did with her according to his vow which he had vowed. And she knew no man. And it was a custom in Israel that the daughters of Israel went yearly to lament the daughter of Jephthah the Gileadite 4 days in a year. Does that mean that he offered her as a burnt offering? Well, you can read it that way. But why would it then say that she knew no man, and they would recome and lament, return and lament? Now, the other idea is that it could be that he dedicated her to the Lord, similar to the way Hannah had done Samuel, remember, the little boy? And so she was going to serve the Lord all her life and never marry. And the old law did provide for things like that. And so that might be how the story came out. I'll tell you, the way the Bible tells it, though, it's somewhat ambiguous, isn't it? And so it's always a discussion, just exactly what did Jephthah do? Now, I've got my opinion on it, but it's not exactly clear. There's a little room for some thought on just how he fulfilled that vow. But whatever he did, he fulfilled the vow as he had promised, even though it was resulted in great grief. Now, I tell that story to emphasize the importance of keeping your promise, especially the importance of keeping your promise to God. But another reason to tell that story, listen, be careful what you promise. And that's what we're getting into now in the book of Ecclesiastes. Keeping that in mind, Ecclesiastes 5, 1 through 3, it says, "Keep thy foot when thou goest into the house of God." You know what "keep thy foot" means? Now, I don't know if any translation does this, but if they told me I could rewrite the Bible any way I wanted to, regardless of what it really said, and I could just kind of paraphrase it, put it in my own words, if I could do that, and I had a good conscience with it, I'd say this. I said, now you watch your step. That's the way we would say it today, isn't it? You watch your step when you go into the house of God. Has your mother ever told you that? You better watch your step, young man. I remember hearing that expression before. And that means you better be careful. This is no time to make a mistake. And so keep thy foot when thou goest in the house of God, and be more ready to hear than to give the sacrifice of fools. Well, you know, James tells us to be swift to hear and slow to speak. We need to be more ready to listen than it is to talk. And we come into the house of God, it's time to pay attention and listen. It's not just time to be rattling off and talking and letting everybody know what you think. Listen, it's time to hear, particularly when it's about what God is having us to listen to say. We need to pay attention to that. And so don't be called up where you have to give a sacrifice and it be the sacrifice of fools. What would be the sacrifice of a fool? Fella that went in there saying too much and got himself involved in a promise that he should not have made. Now he still needs to make the sacrifice. But he should have been smarter than that and not made some of those promises that he made. And so that'd be the sacrifice of fools. Going on, it says here, they consider not that they do evil. Be not rash with thy mouth. Let not thine heart be hasty to utter anything before God. For God is in heaven and thou art on earth. Therefore let thy words be few. You just be careful when you start making promises and vows to God. How many times have you heard someone say, well, if God ever gets me out of this mess, then I'm going to. And then when they come out of the mess there and they don't follow through. They don't do what they said they would do. Well, that's doing evil. And so you be careful what you promise. He goes on and says this. A dream cometh through the multitude of business, and a fool's voice is known by a multitude of words. I've heard it said before that sometimes it's better just to keep your mouth shut and let everyone think that you're a fool than to open your mouth and to remove all doubt. And so let thy words be few is what you do. And particularly now, when it comes to making promises to God. The dream. You know what a dream is? You know, it's easy to dream. People can have, there's difference in a dream and a goal. I tell you, a goal, you're going to have a goal and then you're going to set a plan. You're going to follow through and you're committed. But dreams, you don't have to have any goals for dreams. You can dream anything. But if you start making promises based on shallow dreams, you're getting yourself in trouble. And so be careful. And don't let just a lot of talk and a lot of dreaming get you committed to something that you can't fulfill. When thou vowest a vow unto God, defer not to pay it, for he hath no pleasure in fools. Pay that which thou hast vowed. This really clears up the whole section right here, this whole part summed up right here. Better it is that thou shouldest not vow than that thou shouldest vow and not pay. And then he goes on. Suffer not thy mouth to cause thy flesh to sin. Neither say thou before the angel that it was an error. Now the word translated angel there is the messenger. I don't know that there is a heavenly angel in this situation. The way it'd work, you'd go into the temple and you'd tell the priest, you might be impressed with all the temple and everything, and so you made a vow. And then the priest sends his messenger to receive that which you have vowed. And what are you going to say when the messenger shows up? Oh, that was a mistake. I didn't mean to do that. I really didn't mean it. Sort of like, you know, bill collectors, that's a promise, isn't it? When you say you're going to, and then the bill collector comes knocking on the door like a messenger, or they'll send one, and then you say, oh, that was a mistake. I didn't mean that. Here's what he says. Wherefore should God be angry at thy voice? Don't start making excuses. You take these vows seriously. Wherefore should God be angry at thy voice and destroy the work of thine hands? For in the multitude of dreams and many words, there are also diverse vanities. But fear thou God. Okay, that's the first section. And it's teaching us we've got to keep our promises. Especially when we're talking about we promise something to God, we're held accountable for that. And even though it might be a vow to our hurt, we're to keep our promises, but lest God become angry. Now let's go to the next part. The vanity of oppression. The preacher in the book of Ecclesiastes is kind of going from one little subject here to another through this part. Let's see if we can understand what he's talking about, the vanity of oppression. Some people think, well, if I'll just be hard on folks, that'll be good. But that is not good. Here's what it says. If thou seest the oppression of the poor and violent perverting of judgment and justice in a province, marvel not at the matter. That is so common, especially when you get people put in charge of things and then they've got to exert their authority. And they don't know how to govern well. And they think that to govern well means to be a real tough boss, or a real cruel taskmaster. And they are oppressing the poor. Now don't marvel at that. That is common. That's why you don't marvel at that. But that is not good. He says this, he that is higher than the highest regardeth, and there be higher than they. You know, everybody's got a boss. And your boss has a boss. And that boss has a boss. And you keep tracing this up. The final one to answer to is God. And when someone is abusing the authority they have and they are oppressing people, now God knows about this. And he's going to take this into account. They're going to have to answer to God for that someday. And then this last section. Moreover, the profit of the earth is for all. The king himself is served by the field. It's the earth that brings forth the food that we eat. And everybody eats of the earth. Now the king, he has to do that too. Just because someone is endowed with some earthly authority for a brief period of time doesn't keep them from being a human being. Sometimes we use expression, everybody puts on their britches one leg after another the same way. They're still just a human being. And the king needs to realize this. But there's another way that could be translated, and some of the more modern versions translate it the way about how that the king is wise to have his fields worked so that the profit that comes from the fields is a benefit to all. Kind of like maybe sort of a Solomon talking about an agricultural policy here. But to put it all in context, what does a wise king do? A wise king is going to treat his subjects in a way that they can prosper. Because if they prosper, the kingdom prospers. And if the kingdom prospers, the king prospers. And so it is foolish to put people down in a box and hold them back and oppress them so that they can't benefit and they can't prosper, because then no one is going to prosper. And yet it is so common for people to think, well, I'll give a benefit if I can oppress everyone around me. And that's not the way you do it. The king himself is fed by the field. And so you want things to prosper for the king himself to prosper. And under oppression, things just don't prosper. Let's see what else a preacher has to say tonight. An abundance. You know, it seems like how much is enough? And I know all of us, we get to thinking this way. Oh, I'd have enough if I had a little more. We always think enough is just a little more than what we have. We never had enough. But even with an abundance, there's problems associated with an abundance. So let's listen to the preacher. He that loveth silver shall not be satisfied with silver, nor he that loveth abundance with increase. This also is vanity. I remember a class I was in years ago. I was in seventh grade, Thomas. I'm not sure what grade you're in, but I was in seventh grade, and the teacher made the comment that I remember about money being like salt water. The more you drink, the thirstier you are. And the more you want to drink. And it seems like we can never be satisfied. And some of those with great abundance of riches are those that thirst and thirst. If I could just have more. And so if you like silver, you're never satisfied with silver. I don't know if any of you all collect silver, silverware or anything, but whatever it is. Are you ever satisfied? You got something you like? I tell you, my problem is books. I always want one more book, you know. Or maybe it's guitars. If you had just one more guitar, but whatever it is, if that's your problem, if that's your desire, you're never really satisfied. There's always a little more that you want. And so, when goods increase, now here's what happens. Let's say you get an abundance. When goods increase, they are increased that eat them. And what good is there to the owners thereof saving to behold of them with their eyes? I tell you, you get an abundance that the more you have, the more people want out of you. And they think, well, they need to share that with us. And if you had all of your cupboard stocked, next thing you'd know, there'd be more people at your table trying to eat more. And all you can do is just sit there and watch it go. And so that really isn't the answer to have more and more and more and more, is it? He said, the sleep of a laboring man is sweet, whether he eat little or much, but the abundance of the rich will not suffer him to sleep. Tell you, you want a good life? Get out and work for what you have. If you work for it, you're going to enjoy it. But if you just have it, then the more you have, the more you're going to worry about. I remember when I didn't hardly have anything. I used to not care a bit about money because I didn't have any. And about investment, it never bothered me. What stock market did, I had nothing. And so that didn't bother me. But the more you have, now the more you're worried about it and how you're going to hang on to it and make sure you don't lose it and are you using it wisely. Now the labor, man, you get out and work for it, you can still enjoy it and you can sleep. You get out and do some physical work and it'll give you a good night's sleep. But you get nice and rich where you don't have to do any work, you're going to stay up at night worrying about your riches and you'll lose that sleep. What a vanity. This is a sore evil which I have seen under the sun. Namely, riches kept for the owners thereof to their hurt. You ever seen someone that just what they had, they held on to it until it wound up hurting them that they had it? Where thieves break through and steal or moth and rust doth corrupt. And the very abundance that they sought their security in became the problem that they had to deal with. But those riches perish by evil travail. And he begetteth a son and there's nothing in his hand. Here he wanted to leave it all to a son and wind up he has nothing to leave him because it got away from him. As he came forth of his mother's womb, naked shall he return to go as he came and shall take nothing of his labor, which he may carry away in his hand. I saw a bumper sticker that said, the one who wins is the one who dies with the most toys. I tell you what, that just means he's going to leave more toys behind than the other fella. they talk about the fellas that dug the grave of a Rockefeller. And I'd say that just because Rockefeller's thought to be rich people, and they dug the grave of a Rockefeller. And as the funeral was there and they were lowering him to the ground, one of the grave diggers turned to the other and said, "How much did he leave?" And the other fellow said, "He left it all." You don't take any of it with you. I heard the little story about the fellow. He's going to take it with him. He had it figured out. He's laying there on his deathbed, and before he died, he had his wife gather up all his treasures and put them in the attic above his deathbed, because he figured he'd just take it with him as he left. Well, he died. And she goes up there and looks in the attic, and sure enough, there's all those riches. And she said, "I knew I should have put it in the basement." Well, the point to all this is, you don't take it with you, neither up nor down. You leave every bit of it behind. Now you continue on. But nothing of this earth you take with you. I'll tell you what you can take with you. It won't be anything physical, but every spiritual blessing in Christ is yours. That's what you take with you. All that gratitude, all that true spiritual joy, all the love you've learned to use, you've learned how to take your heart and to be loving with that. Those are the things you take with you. That's why the Bible sometimes talks about us having eternal life. Not that we have it forever while we live, but that quality of life, the spiritual things that we gather in this world, we take with us. It's all the material things that we leave behind, and he can't carry anything away in his hand. This also is a sore evil, that in all points as he came, so shall he go. And what profit hath he that laboreth for the wind? All his days are eaten in darkness, and he hath much sorrow and wrath with his sickness. Well, what are we talking about there? Well, that might begin to bleed into the next thing the preacher is going to talk about. What about someone that had an abundance and then did not have the ability to enjoy it? Maybe they thought, "Boy, I'll travel, I'll do this," but because of sickness or sorrow, they're not able to enjoy the things that they have. And so that's also a vanity with abundance. Just because you have it doesn't mean you're able to enjoy it. You not only have to have the things, you have to be able to enjoy what you have for it to be a profit. And so that leads into the next point. Listen to the old preacher. How to live well. And this is a reoccurring theme in the book of Ecclesiastes. "Behold, that which I have seen, it is good and comely for one to eat and to drink and to enjoy the good of all his labor that he taketh under the sun all the days of his life." Now, it's good to enjoy things. It's not saying don't enjoy the blessings of this life, even the material, physical things. If you got those blessings, be thankful. It's a gift of God, and enjoy that, because God, that's why God wanted you to have that. He wanted you to enjoy it. But then he says this, "Every man also to whom God hath given riches and wealth and hath given him power to eat thereof and to take his portion and to rejoice in his labor." This is the gift of God. It's not just having things, but having things and being able to enjoy them as well. Now, God gives us things to enjoy. And you know, we need to thank God also for the ability to enjoy the things that we have. Because some people have things they don't have the ability to enjoy. And what we have and the ability to enjoy those things, we need to thank God. That keeps us humble, doesn't it? And keeps us appreciative of what we have. And that's the proper attitude to have
toward worldly pleasures. It says, for he shall not much remember. Let's say, God hath given power to eat thereof and take his portion and rejoice in his labor. This is the gift of God. But then this, he shall not remember the days of his life, because God answereth him in the joy of his heart. If you live very long, I know this. I can speak from experience, I think, to some of what Solomon's talking about. I had to work hard. I made, and it was stressful. So, and we had to move, and some of the challenges I faced, and some of them were nerve-wracking, and some of it was long and tedious. But you know what? Now that I've gotten the joy out of that, I hardly ever think about that. I don't remember those days. I don't remember all the struggles I had. I just enjoy the fruits of my labors now. And so God gives us these benefits. It says, he shall not much remember the days of his life. God answereth him in the joy of his heart. Now, I'm going to apply this not just to material things, but think about eternity. Don't we sing in that song? The toils of the road will seem nothing when we get to the end of the way. Anything we have to do to live faithful to God in this life is going to be rewarded in such glory. We're not going to worry about having to do that later on, because we'll have those joys for ourselves. We've got memory work in this section, Ecclesiastes 5, 15 through 16. As he came forth of his mother's womb, naked shall he return to go as he came, and shall take nothing of his labor, which he may carry away in his hand. This also is a sore evil, that in all points as he came, so shall he go. And what profit hath he that laboreth for the wind? You know what the wind here is? It's all those material, temporal things where we focus so much energy, those slip away from us. What then should we labor for? For those spiritual, eternal things that never die. That's where our labors ought to be. And that's why we want to encourage one another and admonish one another when we gather. This can help us focus our lives. I am so thankful that this old preacher took the time to write this down and teach us these things from what he had learned largely from his mistakes, and to show us how to live well and get the very best out of life with an eternity to boot. And to do that now, we need to be a faithful child of God. And that means to hear, believe, and obey the gospel. And that means to be baptized into Christ for the remission of our sins and to live a faithful life. So if you'll do that, you have the opportunity as we sing this closing song.